Here is the basic pattern. First, we avoid what we need to look at because we do not want to feel pain. Then our avoidance produces further problems for us, which we also do not want to look at because they evoke pain. Then the new avoidance produces additional problems we do not care to examine, and so on. Layer of avoidance is piled on layer of avoidance, disowned pain on disowned pain. This is the condition of most adults. Here's the reversal of the basic pattern. First, we decide that our self-esteem and our happiness matter more than short-term discomfort or pain. We take baby steps at being more conscious, self-accepting, responsible, and so on. We notice that when we do this, we like ourselves more. This inspires us to push on and attempt to go farther. We become more truthful with ourselves and others. Self-esteem rises. We take on harder assignments. We feel a little tougher, a little more resourceful. It becomes easier to confront discomforting emotions and threatening situations. We feel we have more assets with which to cope. We become more self-assertive. We feel stronger. We are building the spiritual equivalent of a muscle. Experiencing ourselves as more powerful, we see difficulties in more realistic perspective. We may never be entirely free of fear or pain, but they have lessened immeasurably, and we are not intimidated by them. Integrity feels less threatening and more natural. If the process were entirely easy, if there was nothing hard about it at any point, if perseverance and courage were never needed, everyone would have good self-esteem. But a life without effort, struggle, or suffering is an infant's dream. These are my highlights of Nathaniel Branden's The Six Pillars of Self-Esteem. Introduction. The stability we cannot find in the world, we must create within our own persons. To face life with low self-esteem is to be at a severe disadvantage. In essence, the book consists of my answers to four questions. What is self-esteem? Why is self-esteem important? What can we do to raise the level of our self-esteem? What role do others play in influencing our self-esteem? Self-esteem is shaped by both internal and external factors. By internal, I mean factors residing within or generated by the individual, ideas or beliefs, practices or behaviors. By external, I mean factors in the environment, messages verbally or non-verbally transmitted, or experiences evoked by parents, teachers, significant others, organizations, and culture. Underneath all my work, the core idea I wanted to teach was, your life is important. Honor it. Fight for your highest possibilities. Reflecting on the stories I heard from clients, I looked for a common denominator, and I was struck by the fact that whatever the person's particular complaint, there was always a deeper issue, a sense of inadequacy, of not being enough, a feeling of guilt or shame or inferiority, a clear lack of self-acceptance, self-trust, and self-love. In other words, a problem of self-esteem. I began to wonder if the complaints or symptoms I encountered could be understood either as direct expressions of inadequate self-esteem, for example, feelings of worthlessness or extreme passivity or a sense of futility, or else as defenses against inadequate self-esteem, for example, grandiose bragging or boasting, compulsive sexual acting out, or over-controlling social behavior. As the issue of self-esteem came more clearly into focus for me, I saw that it is a profound and powerful human need, essential to healthy adaptiveness, that is, to optimal functioning and self-fulfillment. To the extent that the need is frustrated, we suffer and are thwarted in it in our development. When I spoke of personal integrity as vital to the protection of a positive self-concept, and the betrayal of integrity as psychologically harmful, no one volunteered agreement or wanted that idea recorded in our report. They preferred to focus only on how others might wound one's feelings of worth, not how one might inflict the wound oneself. In working with self-esteem, we need to be aware of two dangers. One is that of oversimplifying what healthy self-esteem requires, and thereby of catering to people's hunger for quick fixes and effortless solutions. The other is that of surrendering to a kind of fatalism or determinism that assumes, in effect, that individuals either have good self-esteem or they haven't. Part 1. Self-esteem. Basic principles. Self-esteem, the immune system of consciousness. Self-esteem is 1. Confidence in our ability to think, confidence in our ability to cope with the basic challenges of life, and 2. Confidence in our right to be successful and happy, the feeling of being worthy, deserving, entitled to assert our needs and wants, achieve our values, and enjoy the fruits of our efforts. I do not share the belief that self-esteem is a gift we have only to claim by reciting affirmations, perhaps. On the contrary, its possession over time represents an achievement. To trust one's mind and to know that one is worthy of happiness is the essence of self-esteem. There is a continuous feedback loop between our actions in the world and our self-esteem. The level of our self-esteem influences how we act, and how we act influences the level of our self-esteem. If I trust my mind and judgment, I am more likely to operate as a thinking being. Exercising my ability to think, bringing appropriate awareness to my activities, my life works better. This reinforces trust in my mind. If I respect myself and require that others deal with me respectfully, I send out signals and behave in ways that increase the likelihood that others will respond appropriately. When they do, I am reinforced and confirmed in my initial belief. If I lack self-respect and consequently accept discourtesy, abuse, or exploitation from others as natural, I unconsciously transmit this and some people will treat me at my self-estimate. When this happens and I submit to it, my self-respect deteriorates still more. The value of self-esteem lies not merely in the fact that it allows us to feel better, but that it allows us to live better, to respond to challenges and opportunities more resourcefully and more appropriately. High self-esteem seeks the challenge and stimulation of worthwhile and demanding goals. Reaching such goals nurtures good self-esteem. Low self-esteem seeks the safety of the familiar and undemanding. Confining oneself to the familiar and undemanding serves to weaken self-esteem. The higher our self-esteem, the stronger the drive to express ourselves, reflecting the sense of richness within. The lower our self-esteem, the more urgent the need to prove ourselves, or to forget ourselves by living mechanically and unconsciously. The higher our self-esteem, the more open, honest, and appropriate our communications are likely to be, because we believe our thoughts have value and therefore we welcome, rather than fear, clarity. The lower our self-esteem, the more muddy, evasive, and inappropriate our communications are likely to be, because of uncertainty about our own thoughts and feelings and our anxiety about the listener's response. An important principle of human relationships is that we tend to feel most comfortable, most at home, with persons whose self-esteem level resembles our own. Opposites may attract about some issues, but not about this one. High self-esteem individuals tend to be drawn to high self-esteem individuals. The healthier our self-esteem, the more inclined we are to treat others with respect, benevolence, goodwill, and fairness, since we do not tend to perceive them as a threat, and since self-respect is the foundation of respect for others. There is no greater barrier to romantic happiness than the fear that I am undeserving of love and that my destiny is to be hurt. Such fears give birth to self-fulfilling prophecies. Confidence in my competence and worth and in your ability to see and appreciate it also gives birth to self-fulfilling prophecies. If I lack respect for and enjoyment of who I am, I have very little to give except my unfilled needs. In my emotional impoverishment, I tend to see other people essentially as sources of approval or disapproval. I do not appreciate them for who they are in their own right. I see only what they can or cannot do for me. I am not looking for people whom I can admire and with whom I can share the excitement and adventure of life. I am looking for people who will not condemn me and perhaps will be impressed by my persona, the face I present to the world. My ability to love remains undeveloped. If I do not feel lovable, it is very difficult to believe that anyone else loves me. If I do not accept myself, how can I accept your love for me? Your warmth and devotion are confusing. It confounds my self-concept since I know I am not lovable. Your feeling for me cannot possibly be real, reliable, or lasting. If I do not feel lovable, your love for me becomes an effort to fill a sieve, and eventually the effort is likely to exhaust you. I attempt love, but the foundation of inner security is not there. Instead, there is the secret fear that I am destined only for pain. So I pick someone who inevitably will reject or abandon me. In the beginning, I pretend I do not know this, so the drama can be played out. Or if I pick someone with whom happiness might be possible, I subvert the relationship by demanding excessive reassurances, by venting irrational possessiveness, by making catastrophes of small frictions, by seeking to control through subservience or domination, by finding ways to reject my partner before my partner can reject me. When we know we are doomed, we behave in ways to make reality conform to our knowledge. We are anxious when there is dissonance between our knowledge and the perceivable facts. Since our knowledge is not to be doubted or questioned, it is the facts that have to be altered, hence self-sabotage. A man falls in love, the woman returns his feeling, and they marry. But nothing she can do is ever enough to make him feel loved for longer than a moment. He is insatiable. However, she is so committed to him that she perseveres. When at last she convinces him that she really loves him and he is no longer able to doubt it, he begins to wonder whether he has set his standards too low. He wonders whether she is really good enough for him. Eventually, he leaves her, falls in love with another woman, and the dance begins again. The tragedy of many people's lives is that, given a choice between being right and having an opportunity to be happy, they invariably choose being right. That is the one ultimate satisfaction they allow themselves. Note that it is not always necessary to destroy the relationship entirely, as in the vignettes above. It may be acceptable that the relationship continue, providing I am not happy. I may engage in a project called struggling to be happy or working on our relationship. I may read books on the subject, participate in seminars, attend lectures, or enter psychotherapy with the announced aim of being happy in the future, but not now, not today. The possibility of happiness is in the present is too terrifyingly immediate. What is required for many of us, paradoxical though it may sound, is the courage to tolerate happiness without self-sabotage until such time as we lose the fear of it and realize that it will not destroy us and need not disappear. One day at a time, I will tell clients, see if you can get through today without doing anything to undermine or subvert your good feelings, and if you fall off the wagon, don't despair. Pull yourself back and recommit yourself to happiness. Such perseverance is self-esteem building. Further, we need to confront those destructive voices, not run from them. Engage them in inner dialogue, challenge them to give their reasons, patiently answer and refute their nonsense, dealing with them as one might deal with real people, and distinguish them from the voice of our adult self. If I die by my own hand, at least I am still in control. I spare myself the anxiety of waiting for destruction from some unknown source. The anxiety of feeling out of control is unbearable. I must end it any way I can. Generosity toward the achievements of others is emblematic of self-esteem. It would be hard to name a more certain sign of poor self-esteem than the need to perceive some other group as inferior. When our illusion of self-esteem rests on the fragile support of never being challenged, when our insecurity finds evidence of rejection where no rejection exists, then it is only a matter of time until our inner bomb explodes. The form of the explosion is self-destructive behavior, and the fact that one may have an extraordinary intelligence is no protection. Brilliant people with low self-esteem act against their interests every day. When we are moved primarily by fear, sooner or later we precipitate the very calamity we dread. If we fear condemnation, we behave in ways that ultimately elicit disapproval. If we fear anger, eventually we make people angry. Self-esteem creates a set of implicit expectations about what is possible and appropriate to us. These expectations tend to generate the actions that turn them into realities. And the realities confirm and strengthen the original belief. Self-esteem, high or low, tends to be a generator of self-fulfilling prophecies. In fact, a person's image of the future may be a better predictor of future attainment than his past performances. What we make an effort to learn and what we achieve is based, at least in part, on what we think is possible and appropriate to us. Self-concept is destiny. Or more precisely, it tends to be. Our self-concept is who and what we consciously and subconsciously think we are. Our physical and psychological traits are assets and liabilities, possibilities and limitations, strengths and weaknesses. A self-concept contains or includes our level of self-esteem, but is more global. We cannot understand a person's behavior without understanding the self-concept behind it. Happiness anxiety, success anxiety, the dread and disorientation that persons with poor self-esteem experience when life goes well in ways that conflict with their deepest view of themselves and of what is appropriate to them, regardless of the context in which self-destructive behavior occurs or the form it takes, the motor of such behavior is the same, poor self-esteem. It is poor self-esteem that places us in an adversarial relationship to our well-being. If the power of self-esteem derives from the fact that it is a profound need, what precisely is a need? A need is that which is required for our effective functioning. Self-esteem is a need analogous to calcium, rather than to food or water. Lacking it to a serious degree, we do not necessarily die, but we are impaired in our ability to function. For most of us, the consequences of poor self-esteem are subtler, less direct, more circuitous. We may need a good deal of reflection and self-examination to appreciate how our deepest view of ourselves shows up in the 10,000 choices that add up to our destiny. I have come to think of positive self-esteem as, in effect, the immune system of consciousness, providing resistance, strength, and a capacity for regeneration. Just as a healthy immune system does not guarantee that one will never become ill, but makes one less vulnerable to disease and better equipped to overcome it, so a healthy self-esteem does not guarantee that one will never suffer anxiety or depression in the face of life's difficulties, but makes one less susceptible and better equipped to cope, rebound, and transcend. High self-esteem people can surely be knocked down by an excess of troubles, but they are quicker to pick themselves up again. The question is sometimes asked, is it possible to have too much self-esteem? No, it is not. No more than it is possible to have too much physical health or too powerful an immune system. Sometimes self-esteem is confused with boasting or bragging or arrogance, but such traits reflect not too much self-esteem but too little. They reflect a lack of self-esteem. Persons of high self-esteem are not driven to make themselves superior to others. They do not seek to prove their value by measuring themselves against a comparative standard. Their joy is in being who they are, not in being better than someone else. While poor self-esteem often undercuts the capacity for real accomplishment, even among the most talented, it does not necessarily do so. What is far more certain is that it undercuts the capacity for satisfaction. When we have unconflicted self-esteem, joy is our motor, not fear. It is happiness that we wish to experience, not suffering that we wish to avoid. Our purpose is self-expression, not self-avoidance or self-justification. Our motive is not to prove our worth, but to live our possibilities. If my aim is to prove that I am enough, the project goes on to infinity, because the battle was already lost on the day I conceded the issue was debatable. In today's culture, some frustrated people who hit this impasse announced that they have decided to pursue a spiritual path and renounce their egos. This enterprise is doomed to failure. An ego in the mature and healthy sense is precisely what they have failed to attain. They dream of giving away what they do not possess. No one can successfully bypass the need for self-esteem. Contrary to what we sometimes hear, achievement drive is not correlated with self-esteem in any simple or direct way, in that such a drive can be powered by negative motivation as well as by positive, as for example when one is propelled by fear of losing love or status rather than by the joy of self-expression. A well-developed sense of self is a necessary condition of our well-being, but not a sufficient condition. Its presence does not guarantee fulfillment, but its lack guarantees some measure of anxiety, frustration, or despair. We have reached a moment in history when self-esteem, which has always been a supremely important psychological need, has also become a supremely important economic need, the attribute imperative for adaptiveness to an increasingly complex, challenging, and competitive world. Today, organizations need not only an unprecedentedly higher level of knowledge and skill among all those who participate, but also a higher level of independence, self-reliance, self-trust, and the capacity to exercise initiative. In a word, self-esteem. This means that persons with a decent level of self-esteem are now needed economically in large numbers. Historically, this is a new phenomenon. The greater the number of choices and decisions we need to make at a conscious level, the more urgent our need for self-esteem. There are unprecedented choices in clothing styles, foods, automobiles, new products of every kind, all demanding that we make a decision. If we lack adequate self-esteem, the amount of choice offered to us today can be frightening, sometimes like the anxiety of a Soviet citizen on first encountering an American supermarket. The meaning of self-esteem. Self-esteem has two interrelated components. One is the sense of basic confidence in the face of life's challenges, self-efficacy. The other is a sense of being worthy of happiness, self-respect. Self-efficacy means confidence in the functioning of my mind, in my ability to think, understand, learn, choose, and make decisions. Confidence in my ability to understand the facts of reality that fall within the sphere of my interests and needs. Self-trust, self-reliance. Self-respect means assurance of my value, an affirmative attitude toward my right to live and to be happy, comfort in appropriately asserting my thoughts, wants, and needs, the feeling that joy and fulfillment are my natural birthright. Self-esteem is the disposition to experience oneself as competent to cope with the basic challenges of life and as worthy of happiness. To have high self-esteem, then, is to feel confidently appropriate to life, that is, competent and worthy in the sense I have indicated. To have low self-esteem is to feel inappropriate to life, wrong, not about this issue or that, but wrong as a person. To have average self-esteem is to fluctuate between feeling appropriate and inappropriate, right and wrong as a person. And to manifest these inconsistencies in behavior, sometimes acting wisely, sometimes acting foolishly, thereby reinforcing the uncertainty about who one is at one's core. Our need for self-esteem is the result of two basic facts, both intrinsic to our species. The first is that we depend for our survival and our successful mastery of the environment on the appropriate use of our consciousness. Our life and well-being depend on our ability to think. The second is that the right use of our consciousness is not automatic, is not wired in by nature. In the regulating of its activity, there is a crucial element of choice, therefore of personal responsibility. Our human essence is our ability to reason, which means to grasp relationships. It is on this ability, ultimately, that our life depends. Nature has given us an extraordinary responsibility, the option of turning the searchlight of consciousness brighter or dimmer. This is the option of seeking awareness or not bothering to seek it or actively avoiding it. The option of thinking or not thinking. This is the root of our freedom and our responsibility. A disservice is done to people if they are offered feel-good notions of self-esteem that divorce it from questions of consciousness, responsibility, and moral choice. There is great joy in self-esteem and often joy in the process of building or strengthening it, but this should not obscure the fact that more is required than blowing oneself a kiss in the mirror on numerous other strategies that have been proposed of equal profundity. Any time we have to act, to face a challenge, to make a moral decision, we affect our feelings about ourselves for good or for bad, depending on the nature of our response and the mental processes behind it. And if we avoid action and decisions in spite of their obvious necessity, that too affects our sense of self. Our need for self-esteem is the need to know we are functioning as our life and well-being require. To be efficacious, in the basic dictionary sense, is to be capable of producing a desired result. Confidence in our basic efficacy is confidence in our ability to learn what we need to learn, and to do what we need to do in order to achieve our goals, insofar as success depends on our own efforts. To be lacking in the experience of self-efficacy, to anticipate defeat rather than victory, is to be interrupted or undermined or paralyzed to varying degrees in our efforts to cope with the tasks and challenges life presents to us. Who am I to think? Who am I to master challenges? Who am I to choose, decide, leave the comfort of the familiar, persevere in the face of obstacles, fight for my values? Low self-efficacy tends to produce discomfort with the new and unfamiliar and over-attachment to yesterday's skills. Higher self-efficacy makes it easier to move up from an earlier level of knowledge and development and to master new knowledge, skills, and challenges. Sometimes people who feel fear in the human realm drop to a very low level of consciousness in their relationships and seek the safety and security of competence in the impersonal world of machines, mathematics, or abstract thought. No matter what heights they may attain professionally, their self-esteem remains flawed. We cannot with impunity run from so important an aspect of life. Just as self-efficacy entails the expectation of success as natural, so self-respect entails the expectation of friendship, love, and happiness as natural as a result of who we are and what we do. Self-respect is the conviction of our own value. It is not the delusion that we are perfect or superior to everyone else. It is not comparative or competitive at all. It is the conviction that our life and well-being are worth acting to support, protect, and nurture, that we are good and worthwhile and deserving of the respect of others, and that our happiness and personal fulfillment are important enough to work for. Not uncommonly, we meet a person who is far more sure of his or her competence, at least in some areas, than of the right to be happy. Some aspect of self-respect is missing. Such an individual may achieve a great deal, but lack the capacity to enjoy it. To appreciate why our need for self-respect is so urgent, consider the following. To live successfully, we need to pursue and achieve values. To act appropriately, we need to value the beneficiary of our actions. We need to consider ourselves worthy of the rewards of our actions. Absent this conviction, we will not know how to take care of ourselves, protect our legitimate interests, satisfy our needs, or enjoy our own achievements. Thus, our experience of self-efficacy also will be impaired. Three basic observations. 1. If we respect ourselves, we tend to act in ways that confirm and reinforce this respect, such as requiring others to deal with us appropriately. 2. If we do not respect ourselves, we tend to act in ways that lower our sense of our own value even further, such as accepting or sanctioning inappropriate behavior towards us by others, thereby confirming and reinforcing our negativity. 3. If we wish to raise the level of our self-respect, we need to act in ways that will cause it to rise, and this begins with a commitment to the value of our own person, which is then expressed through congruent behavior. Personal integrity is intimately related to the moral aspect of self-esteem. For the optimal realization of our possibilities, we need to trust ourselves and we need to admire ourselves. And the trust and admiration need to be grounded in reality, not generated out of fantasy and self-delusion. If self-esteem pertains to the experience of our fundamental competence and value, pride pertains to the more explicitly conscious pleasure we take in ourselves because of our actions and achievements. Self-esteem contemplates what needs to be done and says, "I can." Pride contemplates what has been accomplished and says, "I did." Pride is the emotional reward of achievement. It is not a vice to be overcome, but a value to be attained. We sometimes hear people say, "I have accomplished so much. Why don't I feel more proud of myself?" Although there are several reasons why someone may not enjoy his or her achievements, it can be useful to ask, who chose your goals? You or the voice of some significant other inside you? Neither pride nor self-esteem can be supported by the pursuit of second-hand values that do not reflect who we really are. The face of self-esteem. Self-esteem expresses itself in a face, manner, and way of talking and moving that projects the pleasure one takes in being alive. It expresses itself in an ease in talking of accomplishments or shortcomings with directness and honesty, since one is in friendly relationship to facts. It expresses itself in the comfort one experiences in giving and receiving compliments, expressions of affection, appreciation, and the like. It expresses itself in an openness to criticism and a comfort about acknowledging mistakes, because one's self-esteem is not tied to an image of being perfect. It expresses itself when one's words and movements tend to have a quality of ease and spontaneity, reflecting the fact that one is not at war with oneself. It expresses itself in the harmony between what one says and does and how one looks, sounds, and moves. It expresses itself in an attitude of openness to and curiosity about new ideas, new experiences, new possibilities of life. It expresses itself in the fact that feelings of anxiety or insecurity, if they appear, will be less likely to intimidate or overwhelm, since accepting them, managing them, and rising above them rarely feel impossibly difficult. It expresses itself in an ability to enjoy the humorous aspects of life in oneself and others. It expresses itself in one's flexibility in responding to situations and challenges, since one trusts one's mind and does not see life as doom or defeat. It expresses itself in one's comfort with assertive, not belligerent, behavior in oneself and others. It expresses itself in an ability to preserve a quality of harmony and dignity under conditions of stress. On the purely physical level, we can observe characteristics such as these. We see eyes that are alert, bright, and lively, a face that is relaxed and, barring illness, tends to exhibit natural color and good skin vibrancy, a chin that is held naturally and in alignment with one's body, and a relaxed jaw. We see shoulders relaxed yet erect, hands that tend to be relaxed and graceful, arms that tend to hang in an easy, natural way, a posture that tends to be unstrained, erect, well-balanced, a walk that tends to be purposeful without being aggressive or overbearing. We hear a voice that tends to be modulated with an intensity appropriate to the situation and with clear pronunciation. Notice that the theme of relaxation occurs again and again. Relaxation implies that we are not hiding from ourselves and are not at war with who we are. Chronic tension conveys a message of some form of internal split, some form of self-avoidance or self-repudiation, some aspect of the self being disowned or held on a very tight leash. Healthy self-esteem is significantly correlated with rationality, realism, intuitiveness, creativity, independence, flexibility, ability to manage change, willingness to admit and correct mistakes, benevolence, and cooperativeness. Rationality. This is the exercise of the integrative function of consciousness, the generation of principles from concrete facts, induction, the application of principles to concrete facts, deduction, and the relating of new knowledge and information to our existing context of knowledge. It is the pursuit of meaning and an understanding of relationships. The quest of reason is for the non-contradictory integration of experience, which implies openness and availability to experience. It is the servant neither of tradition nor consensus. High self-esteem is intrinsically reality-oriented. In tests, low self-esteem individuals tend to underestimate or overestimate their abilities. High self-esteem individuals tend to assess their abilities realistically. Persons of low self-esteem tend to discount the productions of their mind. It is not that they never get worthwhile ideas, but they do not value them, do not treat them as potentially important, often do not even remember them very long, rarely follow through with them. In effect, their attitude is, if the idea is mine, how good can it be? Rigidity is often the response of a mind that does not trust itself to cope with the new or master the unfamiliar, or that has simply become complacent or even slovenly. Flexibility, in contrast, is the natural consequence of self-esteem. A mind that trusts itself is light on its feet, unencumbered by irrelevant attachments, able to respond quickly to novelty because it is open to seeing. Willingness to admit and correct mistakes. A basic characteristic of healthy self-esteem is a strong reality orientation. Facts are a higher priority than beliefs. Truth is a higher value than having been right. Consciousness is perceived as more desirable than self-protective unconsciousness. If self-trust is tied to respect for reality, then correcting an error is esteemed above pretending not to have made one. Healthy self-esteem is not ashamed to say, when the occasion warrants it, I was wrong. Denial and defensiveness are characteristics of insecurity, guilt, feelings of inadequacy, and shame. It is low self-esteem that experiences a simple admission of error as humiliation and even self-damnation. Empathy and compassion, no less than benevolence and cooperativeness, are far more likely to be found among persons of high self-esteem than among low. My relationship to others tend to mirror and reflect my relationship to myself. The illusion of self-esteem. If we feel in any sense whatever that reality is the enemy of our self-esteem or pretense at it, these fears tend to sabotage the efficacy of consciousness, thereby worsening the initial problem. Not that the level of our self-esteem determines our thinking, the causation is not that simple. What self-esteem affects is our emotional incentives. Our feelings tend to encourage or discourage thinking, to draw us towards facts, truth, and reality, or away from them, toward efficacy or away from it. That is why the first steps of building self-esteem can be difficult. We are challenged to raise the level of our consciousness in the face of emotional resistance. The base and motor of poor self-esteem is not confidence, but fear. Not to live, but to escape the terror of life is the fundamental goal. Not creativity, but safety is the ruling desire. And what is sought from others is not the chance to experience real contact, but an escape from moral values, a promise to be forgiven, to be accepted, on some level to be taken care of. If low self-esteem dreads the unknown and unfamiliar, high self-esteem seeks new frontiers. If low self-esteem avoids challenges, high self-esteem desires and needs them. If low self-esteem looks for a chance to be absolved, high self-esteem looks for an opportunity to admire. Pseudo self-esteem is the illusion of self-efficacy and self-respect without the reality. It is a non-rational self-protective device to diminish anxiety and to provide a spurious sense of security. To assuage our need for authentic self-esteem while allowing the real causes of its lack to remain unexamined. Nothing is more common than to pursue self-esteem by means that will not and cannot work. Instead of seeking self-esteem through consciousness, responsibility, and integrity, we may seek it through popularity, material acquisitions, or sexual exploits. Self-esteem is an intimate experience. It resides in the core of one's being. It is what I think and feel about myself, not what someone else thinks or feels about me. This simple fact can hardly be overemphasized. I can be loved by my family, my mate, and my friends, and yet not love myself. To attain success without attaining positive self-esteem is to be condemned to feeling like an imposter, anxiously awaiting exposure. The acclaim of others does not create our self-esteem. Neither does erudition, material possessions, marriage, parenthood, philanthropic endeavors, sexual conquests, or facelifts. These things can sometimes make us feel better about ourselves temporarily or more comfortable in particular situations. But comfort is not self-esteem. The tragedy of many people's lives is that they look for self-esteem in every direction except within, and so they fail in their search. In this book, we shall see that positive self-esteem is best understood as a spiritual attainment, that is, as a victory in the evolution of consciousness. Nurturing relationships are obviously preferable to toxic ones, but to look to others as a primary source of our self-value is dangerous. First, because it doesn't work, and second, because it exposes us to the danger of becoming approval addicts. Innovators and creators are persons who can, to a higher degree than average, accept the condition of aloneness, that is, the absence of supportive feedback from their social environment. They are more willing to follow their vision, even when it takes them far from the mainland of the human community. Unexplored spaces do not frighten them, or not at any rate as much as they frighten those around them. This is one of the secrets of their power, the great artists, scientists, inventors, industrialists. It's not the hallmark of the entrepreneurship, in art or science no less than in business, the ability to see a possibility that no one else sees, and to actualize it. Part 2. Internal sources of self-esteem. The focus on action. In approaching the roots of self-esteem, why do we put our focus on practices, that is, on mental or physical actions? The answer is that every value pertaining to life requires action to be achieved, sustained, or enjoyed. In Ayn Rand's definition, life is a process of self-generated and self-sustaining action. The organs and systems within our body support our existence by continuous action. We pursue and maintain our values in the world through action. What determines the level of self-esteem is what the individual does within the context of his or her knowledge and values. If we have parents who raise us with love and respect, who allow us to experience consistent and benevolent acceptance, who give us the supporting structure of reasonable rules and appropriate expectations, who do not assail us with contradictions, who do not resort to ridicule, humiliation, or physical abuse as means of controlling us, who project that they believe in our competence and goodness, we have a decent chance of internalizing their attitudes and thereby of acquiring the foundation for healthy self-esteem. If one lives in a sane human environment in which reality is respected and people's behavior is congruent, it is far easier to persevere in efforts to be rational and productive than if the signals are always switching, nothing seems real, facts are denied, and consciousness is penalized. Families that create such destructive environments are described as dysfunctional. Just as there are dysfunctional families, there are dysfunctional schools and dysfunctional organizations. They are dysfunctional because they place obstacles in the path of the appropriate exercise of mind. It is self-deceiving to believe that what one says can communicate more powerfully than what one manifests in one's person. We must become what we wish to teach. In the course of this book, I give many examples of how sentence completion exercises can be used to strengthen self-esteem. Sentence completion work is a tool both of therapy and of research. Having begun working with it in 1970, I have found increasingly more extensive and illuminating ways to use it to facilitate self-understanding, melt repressive barriers, liberate self-expression, activate self-healing, and continually test and retest my own hypotheses. The essence of the method is that the client or subject is given a sentence stem, an incomplete sentence, and asked to repeat the stem over and over again, each time providing a different ending. Then another stem is given, and then another, allowing one to explore a particular area at deeper and deeper levels. This work may be done verbally or in writing. Since self-esteem is a consequence, a product of internally generated practices, we cannot work on self-esteem directly, neither our own nor anyone else's. We must address ourselves to the source. If we understand what these practices are, we can commit to initiating them within ourselves and to dealing with others in such a way as to facilitate or encourage them to do likewise. To encourage self-esteem in the schools or in the workplace, for instance, is to create a climate that supports and reinforces the practices that strengthen self-esteem. The practice of living consciously. We identify increasing maturity with wider vision, greater awareness, higher consciousness. Why is consciousness so important? Because for all species that possess it, consciousness is the basic tool of survival. The ability to be aware of the environment in some form, at some level, and to guide action accordingly. We are beings for whom consciousness at the conceptual level is volitional. This means that the design of our nature contains an extraordinary option, that of seeking awareness or not bothering, or actively avoiding it, seeking truth or not bothering, or actively avoiding it, focusing on our mind or not bothering, or choosing to drop to a lower level of consciousness. In other words, we have the option of exercising our powers or of subverting our means of survival and well-being. This capacity for self-management is our glory and, at times, our burden. We cannot feel competent and worthy while conducting our lives in a mental fog. Our mind is our basic tool of survival. Betray it and self-esteem suffers. Self-esteem is the reputation we acquire with ourselves. To live consciously means to seek to be aware of everything that bears on our actions, purposes, values, and goals, to the best of our ability, whatever that ability may be, and to behave in accordance with that which we see and know. Consciousness that is not translated into appropriate action is a betrayal of consciousness. It is mind invalidating itself. To operate consciously does not mean always to be in the same mental state, but rather to be in the state appropriate to what I am doing. Living consciously is living responsibly toward reality. We do not necessarily have to like what we see, but we recognize that that which is, and that which is not, is not. Living consciously entails a mind that is active rather than passive, an intelligence that takes joy in its own function, being in the moment without losing the wider context, reaching out toward relevant facts rather than withdrawing from them, being concerned to distinguish among facts, interpretations, and emotions, noticing and confronting my impulses to avoid or deny painful or threatening realities, being concerned to know where I am relative to my various personal and professional goals and projects, and whether I am succeeding or failing, being concerned to know if my actions are in alignment with my purposes, searching for feedback from the environment so as to adjust or correct my course when necessary, persevering in the attempt to understand in spite of difficulties, being receptive to new knowledge and willing to re-examine old assumptions, being willing to see and correct mistakes, seeking always to expand awareness, a commitment to learning, therefore a commitment to growth as a way of life, a concern to understand the world around me, a concern to know not only external reality, but also internal reality, the reality of my needs, feelings, aspirations, and motives, so that I am not a stranger or a mystery to myself. A concern to be aware of the values that move and guide me, as well as their roots, so that I am not ruled by values I have irrationally adopted or uncritically accepted from others. Reaching out toward relevant facts rather than withdrawing from them. What determines relevance is my needs, wants, values, goals, and actions. Do I stay alert to and curious about any information that might cause me to modify my course or correct my assumptions? Or do I proceed on the premise that there's nothing new for me to learn? Do I continually seek out new data actively that might be helpful? Or do I close my eyes to it even when it is presented? To live consciously, I need to be sensitive to these distinctions. What I perceive, what I interpret it to mean, and how I feel about it are three separate questions. If I do not distinguish among them, my grounding in reality becomes the first casualty. Self-esteem asks not for flawless success, but for the earnest intention to be conscious. Living consciously entails monitoring my actions relative to my goals, looking for evidence of alignment or misalignment. If there is misalignment, either my actions or my goals need to be rethought. A business leader who operates at a high level of consciousness plans for tomorrow's market. A leader operating at a more modest level thinks in terms of today's. A leader operating at a low level may not realize that he is still thinking in terms of yesterday's. Churchill stood up, looked down at the class, and thundered, "Never, never, 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 never give up." Then he sat down. Of course, sometimes we may rationally choose to discontinue our efforts to understand or master something because in the context of our other values and concerns, a further expenditure of time, energy, and resources is unjustified. But that is a different issue and of our immediate point, except to note that the decision to discontinue should be conscious. Living consciously implies that my first loyalty is to truth, not to making myself right. All of us are wrong some of the time, all of us make mistakes, but if we have tied our self-esteem or our pseudo-self-esteem to being above error, or if we have become over-attached to our own positions, we are obliged to shrink consciousness in misguided self-protection. To find it humiliating to admit an error is a certain sign of flawed self-esteem. Only a commitment to lifelong learning can allow us to remain adaptive to our world. Those who believe they have thought enough and learned enough are on a downward trajectory of increasing unconsciousness. The avoidance of consciousness is clearly evident in problems of addiction. When we become addicted to alcohol or drugs or destructive relationships, the implicit intention is invariably to ameliorate anxiety or pain, to escape awareness of one's core feelings of powerlessness and suffering. What we have become addicted to are tranquilizers and anodynes. Anxiety and pain are not extinguished, they are merely rendered less conscious. Since they inevitably resurface with still greater intensity, larger and larger doses of poison are needed to keep consciousness at bay. Self-destruction is an act best performed in the dark. If for 2 weeks I had sat at my desk each morning and wrote the following incomplete sentence in my notebook, if I bring a higher level of consciousness into my relationship with Barbara, and then wrote 6 to 10 endings as rapidly as I could without rehearsing, censoring, planning, or thinking, I would have found myself making more and more conscious, explicit, and inescapable all the deep reservations I had about this relationship, as well as my process of avoidance and denial. I have given this exercise to clients who are confused or conflicted about some relationship, and the result almost invariably is major clarification. Sometimes the relationship radically improves, sometimes it ends. When body therapists work to release the breathing and open areas of tight muscular contraction, the person feels more and is more aware. Bodywork can liberate blocked consciousness. Clients who bring a lot of consciousness to the work do better than clients who are more passive, who just show up and expect the therapist to do everything. Sentence completion work is a deceptively simple yet uniquely powerful tool for raising self-understanding, self-esteem, and personal effectiveness. It rests on the premise that all of us have more knowledge than we normally are aware of, more wisdom than we use, more potentials than typically show up in our behavior. Sentence completion is a tool for accessing and activating these hidden resources. We tend to be more conscious in some areas of our life than in others. The ways we know what area of our life needs more awareness are usually fairly obvious. We look at the area where our life is working least satisfactorily. The practice of self-acceptance. Whereas self-esteem is something we experience, self-acceptance is something we do. Stated in the negative, self-acceptance is my refusal to be in an adversarial relationship to myself. Some people are self-rejecting at so deep a level that no growth work can even begin until and unless this problem is addressed. If it is not, no treatment will hold, no new learning will be properly integrated, no significant advances can be made. Psychotherapists who do not understand this problem or do not detect its presence will be baffled as to why certain clients, even after years of therapy, show no important improvement. I choose to value myself, to treat myself with respect, to stand up for my right to exist. This primary act of self-affirmation is the base on which self-esteem develops. Self-acceptance entails our willingness to experience, that is to make real to ourselves without denial or evasion, that we think what we think, feel what we feel, desire what we desire, have done what we have done, and are what we are. It is the refusal to regard any part of ourselves, our bodies, our emotions, our thoughts, our actions, our dreams, as alien, as not me. To accept is more than simply to acknowledge or admit. It is to experience, stand in the presence of, contemplate the reality of, absorb into my consciousness. I need to open myself to and fully experience unwanted emotions, not just perfunctorily recognize them. Self-acceptance is the precondition of change and growth. Thus, if I am confronted with a mistake I have made, in accepting that it is mine, I am free to learn from it and to do better in the future. I cannot learn from a mistake I cannot accept having made. Accepting does not necessarily mean liking, enjoying, or condoning. I can accept what is and be determined to evolve from there. It is not acceptance but denial that leaves me stuck. We do not understand another human being when we know only what he or she did is wrong, unkind, destructive, or whatever. We need to know the internal considerations that prompted the behavior. There is always some context in which the most offensive actions can have their own kind of sense. This does not mean they are justified, only that they can be understandable. The act of experiencing and accepting our emotions is implemented through 1. Focusing on the feeling or emotion, 2. Breathing gently and deeply, allowing muscles to relax, allowing the feeling to be felt, and 3. Making real that this is my feeling, which we call owning it. As a psychotherapist, I see that nothing does as much for an individual's self-esteem as becoming aware of and accepting disowned parts of the self. The first steps of healing and growth are awareness and acceptance, consciousness and integration. They are the fountainhead of personal development. If we can accept the fact that right now, at this moment, we refuse to accept that we feel envy or anger or pain or longing, for example, or that we refuse to accept that we once did or believed such and such, if we acknowledge, experience, and accept our resistance, we discover a supremely important paradox. The resistance begins to collapse. When we fight a block, it grows stronger. When we acknowledge, experience, and accept it, it begins to melt because its continued existence requires opposition. We typically encounter 2 fallacious assumptions when people have difficulty with the idea of self-acceptance. 1 is the belief that if we accept who and what we are, we must approve of everything about us. The other is the belief that if we accept who and what we are indifferent to change or improvement. I don't want to accept myself, I want to learn to be different. There is a paradox here, a paradox, not a contradiction. Acceptance of what is the precondition of change, and denial of what is leaves me stuck in it. We can be as frightened of our assets as of our shortcomings, as frightened of our genius, ambition, excitement, or beauty as of emptiness, passivity, depression, or unattractiveness. If our liabilities pose the problem of inadequacy, our assets pose the challenge of responsibility. The greatest crime we commit against ourselves is not that we may deny or disown our shortcomings, but that we deny and disown our greatness. The practice of self-responsibility. Self-responsibility is essential to self-esteem, and it is also a reflection or manifestation of self-esteem. The relationship between self-esteem and its pillars is always reciprocal. The practices that generate self-esteem are also natural expressions and consequences of self-esteem. The practice of self-responsibility entails these realizations. I am responsible for the achievement of my desires. I am responsible for my choices and actions. I am responsible for the level of consciousness I bring to my work. I am responsible for the level of consciousness I bring to my relationships. I am responsible for my behavior with other people, co-workers, associates, customers, spouse, children, friends. I am responsible for how I prioritize my time. I am responsible for the quality of my communications. I am responsible for my personal happiness. I am responsible for accepting or choosing the values by which I live. I am responsible for raising my self-esteem. No one owes me the fulfillment of my wishes. I do not hold a mortgage on anyone else's life or energy. If I have desires, it is up to me to discover how to satisfy them. If I am unwilling to take responsibility for the attainment of my desires, they are not really desires, they are merely daydreams. For any professed desire to be taken seriously, I must be prepared to answer in realistic terms, what am I willing to do to get what I want? Self-esteem is not a gift I can receive from someone else. It is generated from within. To wait passively for something to happen that will raise my self-esteem is to sentence myself to a life of frustration. When people lack healthy self-esteem, they often identify self-esteem with being loved. If they did not feel loved by their families, sometimes they comfort themselves with the thought that God loves them, and they try to tie their self-esteem to this idea. With the best will in the world, how can we understand this strategy except as a manifestation of passivity? I do not support the grandiose notion that I am responsible for every aspect of my existence and everything that befalls me. Some things we have control over, others we do not. If I hold myself responsible for matters beyond my control, I put my self-esteem in jeopardy, since inevitably I will fail my expectations. If I deny responsibility for matters that are within my control, again, I jeopardize my self-esteem. I need to know the difference between that which is up to me and that which is not. The only consciousness over which I have volitional control is my own. In every organization, we encounter both types: those who wait for someone else to provide a solution and those who take responsibility for finding it. It is only by grace of the second type that organizations are able to operate effectively. To the extent that I evade responsibility, I inflict wounds on my self-esteem. In accepting responsibility, I build my self-esteem. Self-responsibility is expressed through an active orientation to life. It is expressed through the understanding that no one is here on earth to spare us the necessity of independence, and through the understanding that without work, independence is impossible. To speak of thinking independently is useful because the redundancy has value in terms of emphasis. Often what people call thinking is merely recycling the opinion of others. A consistent application of the principle of self-responsibility implies the following rule of human relationships. Never ask a person to act against his or her self-interest as he or she understands it. If we wish people to take some action or provide some value, we are obliged to offer reasons that are meaningful and persuasive in terms of their interests and goals. This policy is the moral foundation of mutual respect, goodwill, and the benevolence among human beings. It rejects the notion that some people may be treated as sacrificial fodder for the goals of others, which is the premise underlying all dictatorships and, for that matter, most political systems. Having worked with people for so many years with the aim of building self-esteem, I have always been on the lookout for decisive moments in psychotherapy, instances where a click seems to occur in the client's mind and new forward motion begins. One of the most important of such moments is when the client grasps that no one is coming. No one is coming to save me. No one is coming to make my life right for me. No one is coming to solve my problems. If I don't do something, nothing is going to get better. The dream of a rescuer who will deliver us may offer a kind of comfort, but it leaves us passive and powerless. We may feel, if only I suffer long enough, if only I yearn desperately enough, somehow a miracle will happen. But this is the kind of self-deception one pays for with one's life as it drains away into the abyss of unredeemable possibilities and irretrievable days, months, decades. The practice of self-assertiveness. Self-assertiveness means honoring my wants, needs, and values and seeking appropriate forms of their expression in reality. Its opposite is that surrender to timidity that consists of consigning myself to a perpetual underground where everything that I am lies hidden or stillborn, to avoid confrontation with someone whose values differ from mine, or to please, placate, or manipulate someone, or simply to belong. It means the refusal to fake my person to be liked. To ask questions is an act of self-assertion. To challenge authority is an act of self-assertion. To think for oneself and to stand by what one thinks is the root of self-assertion. To default on this responsibility is to default on the self at the most basic level. While healthy self-assertiveness requires the ability to say no, it is ultimately tested not by what we are against, but by what we are for. Self-assertiveness entails bringing ourselves into the world. To aspire is not yet self-assertion, or just barely, but to bring our aspirations into reality is. To hold values is not yet self-assertion, or just barely. To pursue them and to stand by them in the world is. To practice self-assertiveness logically and consistently is to be committed to my right to exist, which proceeds from the knowledge that my life does not belong to others and that I am not here on earth to live up to someone else's expectations. It often takes courage to honor what we want and to fight for it. For many people, self-surrender and self-sacrifice are far easier. They do not require the integrity and responsibility that intelligent selfishness requires. The sad irony is that when people cease to honor or even attend to their deepest needs and wants, they sometimes become selfish, not in the noble, but in the petty sense, grasping at trivia after they have surrendered their deeper yearnings, rarely even knowing what they have betrayed and given up. A project manager remarked to me, "I'd rather worry about handling some egomaniac who thinks he is the whole project than struggle with some self-doubting but talented individual whose insecurities stop him from kicking in what he's got to offer." Without appropriate self-assertiveness, we are spectators, not participants. Healthy self-esteem asks that we leap into the arena, that we be willing to get our hands dirty. Self-assertion entails the willingness to confront rather than evade the challenges of life and to strive for mastery. When we expand the boundaries of our ability to cope, we expand self-efficacy and self-respect. When we commit ourselves to new areas of learning, when we take on tasks that stretch us, we raise personal power. We thrust ourselves further into the universe. We assert our existence. The American tradition is one of individualism, and some expressions of self-assertiveness are relatively more acceptable in the United States than in some other cultures. Not all cultures attach the value to the individual that we do. In our society or any other, if one believes that it is more desirable to fit in than to stand out, one will not embrace the virtue of self-assertiveness. If one's primary source of safety and security is through affiliation with a tribe, the family, the group, the community, the company, the collective, then even self-esteem can be perceived as threatening and frightening because it signifies individuation, self-realization, the unfolding of personal identity, therefore separateness. Individuation raises the specter of isolation to those who have not achieved it, and do not understand that far from being the enemy of community, it is its necessary precondition. A healthy society is a union of self-respecting individuals. It is not a coral bush. A well-realized man or woman is one who has moved successfully along two lines of development that serve and complement each other, the track of individuation and the track of relationship. Autonomy on the one hand, the capacity for intimacy and human connectedness on the other. Persons with an underdeveloped sense of identity often tell themselves, if I express myself, I may evoke disapproval. If I love and affirm myself, I may evoke resentment. If I am too happy with myself, I may evoke jealousy. If I stand out, I may be compelled to stand alone. They remain frozen in the face of such possibilities and pay a terrible price in loss of self-esteem. Some people stand and move as if they have no right to the space they occupy. Some speak as if their intention is that you not be able to hear them, either because they mumble or speak faintly or both. Some signal at the most crudely obvious level that they do not feel they have a right to exist. They embody lack of self-assertiveness in its most extreme form. Their poor self-esteem is obvious. In therapy, when such men and women learn to move and speak with more assurance, they invariably report, after some initial anxiety, a rise in self-esteem. When we do not express ourselves, do not assert our being, do not stand up for our values in contexts where it is appropriate to do so, we inflict wounds on our sense of self. The world does not do it to us, we do it to ourselves. No amount of admiration for another human being can justify sacrificing one's judgment. Of course, there are other ways to work with these stems. In my self-esteem groups, for instance, we might work with all the stems on this list in one 3-hour session, speaking our endings aloud, then discussing our endings and their action implications. It is a mistake to look at someone who is self-assured and say, it's easy for her to be self-assertive, she has good self-esteem. One of the ways we build self-esteem is by being self-assertive when it is not easy to do so. There are always times when self-assertiveness calls on our courage. The practice of living purposefully. To live without purpose is to live at the mercy of chance, the chance event, the chance phone call, the chance encounter, because we have no standard by which to judge what is or is not worth doing. To live purposefully is to use our powers for the attainment of goals we have selected, the goal of studying, of raising a family, of earning a living, of starting a new business, of bringing a new product into the marketplace, of solving a scientific problem, of building a vacation home, of sustaining a happy romantic relationship. It is our goals that lead us forward, that call on the exercise of our faculties that energize our existence. Self-responsible men and women do not pass to others the burden of supporting their existence. It is not the degree of a person's productive ability that matters here, but the person's choice to exercise such ability as he or she possesses. Nor is it the kind of work selected that is important, provided the work is not intrinsically anti-life, but whether a person seeks work that offers an outlet for his or her intelligence if the opportunity to do so exists. If we know the kind of goals people choose, we can know a good deal about their vision of themselves and about what they think is possible and appropriate to them. The purposes that move us need to be specific if they are to be realized. I cannot organize my behavior optimally if my goal is merely to do my best. The assignment is too vague. My goal needs to be to exercise on the treadmill for 30 minutes 4 times a week, to complete my precisely defined task within 10 days, to communicate to my team at our next meeting exactly what the project requires, to earn a specific sum of money in commissions by the end of the year, to achieve a specific market niche by a specific means by a specific target date. With such specificity, I am able to monitor my progress, compare intentions with results, modify my strategy or my tactics in response to new information, and be accountable for the results I produce. To live purposefully means to live at a high level of consciousness. It is easier for people to understand these ideas as applied to work than to personal relationships. That may be why more people make a success of their work life than of their marriages. Everyone knows it. It is not enough to say, "I love my work." One must show up at the office and do something. Otherwise, the business moves towards non-existence. In intimate relationships, however, it is easy to imagine that love is enough, that happiness will just come, and if it doesn't, this means we are wrong for each other. People rarely ask themselves, "If my goal is to have a successful relationship, what must I do? What actions are needed to create and sustain trust, intimacy, continuing self-disclosure, excitement, growth?" Purposes unrelated to a plan of action do not get realized. They exist only as frustrated yearnings. Daydreams do not produce the experience of efficacy. To live purposefully and productively requires that we cultivate within ourselves a capacity for self-discipline. Self-discipline is the ability to organize our behavior over time in the service of specific tasks. Self-discipline requires the ability to defer immediate gratification in the service of a remote goal. A purposeful, self-disciplined life does not mean a life without time or space for rest, relaxation, recreation, random or even frivolous activity. It merely means that such activities are chosen consciously with the knowledge that it is safe and appropriate to engage in them. And in any event, the temporary abandonment of purpose also serves a purpose, whether consciously intended or not, that of regeneration. The practice of living purposefully entails the following core issues: taking responsibility for formulating one's goals and purposes consciously, being concerned to identify the actions necessary to achieve one's goals, monitoring behavior to check that it is in alignment with one's goals, paying attention to the outcomes of one's actions to know whether they are leading where one wants to go. If our purposes are to be purposes and not daydreams, we need to ask, how do I get there from here? What actions are necessary? What sub-purposes must be accomplished on the way to my ultimate purpose? If new knowledge is required, how will I obtain it? If new resources are needed, how will I acquire them? If our goals are long-range ones, action plans will almost certainly entail sub-action plans. That is, plans for the attainment of sub-purposes. Do we take responsibility for thinking these steps out? Success in life belongs to those who do. We can have clearly defined purposes and a reasonable action plan, but drift off course by distractions, the emergence of unanticipated problems, the pull of other values, an unconscious reordering of priorities, lack of adequate mental focus, or resistance to doing what one has committed oneself to do. A conscious policy of monitoring actions relative to stated purposes helps us to manage problems of this kind. Sometimes the solution will be to rededicate ourselves to our original intentions. Sometimes we will need to rethink what our most important goals actually are and perhaps reformulate our purposes. We need to keep asking, are my strategy and tactics working? Am I getting where I want to go? Are my actions producing the results I anticipated? A life without purpose can hardly be said to be human. The root of our self-esteem is not our achievements, but those internally generated practices that, among other things, make it possible for us to achieve. Steel industrialist Andrew Carnegie once stated, "You can take away our factories, take away our trade, our avenues of transportation, and our money, leave us with nothing but our organization, and in 4 years we could reestablish ourselves. His point was that power lies in the source of wealth, not in the wealth, in the cause, not the effect. The same principle applies to the relationship between self-esteem and external achievements. It is bad enough during economic hard times to have to worry about money and our family's welfare and future, but it is still worse if we allow our self-esteem to become undermined in the process by telling ourselves, in effect, that our efficacy and worth are a function of our earnings. When a question of self-esteem is involved, the question to ask is this matter within my direct volitional control? Or is it at least linked by a direct line of causality to matters within my direct volitional control? If it isn't, it is irrelevant to self-esteem and should be perceived to be, however painful or even devastating the problem may be on other grounds. To the extent that our goal is to prove ourselves or to ward off the fear of failure, this balance is difficult to achieve. We are too driven. Not joy but anxiety is our motor. But if our aim is self-expression rather than self-justification, the balance tends to come more naturally. We will still need to think about its daily implementation, but the anxiety of wounded self-esteem will not make the task nearly impossible. If I don't do something, nothing is going to change. If you made it your conscious purpose to achieve that desire, I asked, what might you do? The practice of personal integrity. Integrity is the integration of ideals, convictions, standards, beliefs, and behavior. When our behavior is congruent with our professed values, when ideals and practice match, we have integrity. When we behave in ways that conflict with our judgment of what is appropriate, we lose face in our own eyes. We respect ourselves less. Integrity means congruence. Words and behavior match. There are people we know whom we trust, and others we do not. If we ask ourselves the reason, we will see that congruence is basic. We trust congruency and are suspicious of incongruency. There are parents whom their children trust, and there are parents whom their children do not trust. Why? The principle is the same as above, congruence. Children may not be able to articulate what they know, but they know. If, however, I act against what I myself regard as right, if my actions clash with my expressed values, then I act against my judgment, I betray my mind. Hypocrisy, by its very nature, is self-invalidating. It is mind rejecting itself. A default on integrity undermines me and contaminates my sense of self. It damages me as no external rebuke or rejection can damage me. The implication is that my judgment is unimportant and that only the judgment of others counts. But when it comes to matters of self-esteem, I have more to fear from my own judgment than from anyone else's. In the inner courtroom of my mind, mine is the only judgment that counts. My ego, the I at the center of my consciousness, is the judge from whom there is no escape. I can avoid people who have learned the humiliating truth about me. I cannot avoid myself. Most of the issues of integrity we face are not big issues, but small ones, yet the accumulated weight of our choices has an impact on our sense of self. A tragedy of many lives is that people greatly underestimate the self-esteem costs and consequences of hypocrisy and dishonesty. They imagine that at worst all that is involved is some discomfort, but it is the spirit itself that is contaminated. The protection of self-esteem requires a clear understanding of the limits of personal responsibility. Where there is no power, there can be no responsibility, and where there is no responsibility, there can be no reasonable self-reproach. Regret? Yes. Guilt? No. The idea of original sin, of guilt where there is no possibility of innocence, no freedom of choice, no alternatives available, is anti-self-esteem by its very nature. The very notion of guilt without volition or responsibility is an assault on reason as well as on morality. Once we see that living up to our standards appears to be leading us towards self-destruction, the time has come to question our standards rather than simply resigning ourselves to living without integrity. We must summon the courage to challenge some of our deepest assumptions concerning what we have been taught to regard as the good. The higher the level of consciousness at which we operate, the more we live by explicit choice, and the more naturally does integrity follow as a consequence. The challenge for people today, and it is not an easy one, is to maintain high personal standards while feeling that one is living in a moral sewer. Grounds for such a feeling are to be found in the behavior of our public figures, the horror of world events, and in our so-called art and entertainment, so much of which celebrates depravity, cruelty, and mindless violence. All contribute to making the practice of personal integrity a lonely and heroic undertaking. About all six pillars, it might be asked, to practice them, does one not need already to possess self-esteem? How then can they be the foundation of self-esteem? In answering, I must introduce what I call the principle of reciprocal causation. By this, I mean that behaviors that generate good self-esteem are also expressions of good self-esteem. Living consciously is both a cause and an effect of self-efficacy and self-respect. And so is self-acceptance, self-responsibility, and all other practices I describe. The practice of these virtues over time tends to generate a felt need for them. If I habitually operate at a high level of consciousness, unclarity and fog in my awareness will make me uncomfortable. The philosophy of self-esteem. Convictions are important because they give rise to emotions and actions, practices. Action has the last word in that no living value can be achieved or sustained without it. Beliefs in a vacuum, beliefs divorced from action, mean nothing. If someone I like does not return my feeling, it may be disappointing or even painful, but it is not a reflection on my personal worth. If I persevere and if my goals are realistic, I am competent to achieve them. If I understand the wider context in which I live and act, I will be more effective. It is worth my while to seek to understand my environment and the wider world around me. To remain effective, I need to keep expanding my knowledge. Learning needs to be a way of life. The better I know and understand myself, the better the life I can create. Self-examination is an imperative of a fulfilled existence. In the ultimate sense, I accept my aloneness. That is, I accept that no one is coming to make my life right, or save me, or redeem my childhood, or rescue me from the consequences of my choices and actions. In specific issues, people may help me, but no one can take over primary responsibility for my existence. Just as no one else can breathe for me, no one else can take over any of my other basic life functions, such as earning the experience of self-efficacy and self-respect. In general, it is appropriate for me to express my thoughts, convictions, and feelings unless I am in a context where I judge it objectively desirable not to. I must practice self-discipline not as a sacrifice, but as a natural precondition of being able to achieve my desires. My self-esteem is more valuable than any short-term rewards for its betrayal. Part 3. External influences, self and others. nurturing a child's self-esteem. The proper aim of parental nurturing is to prepare a child for independent survival as an adult. An infant begins in a condition of total dependency. If his or her upbringing is successful, the young man or woman will have evolved out of that dependency into a self-respecting and self-responsible human being who is able to respond to the challenges of life competently and enthusiastically. He or she will be self-supporting, not merely financially, but intellectually and psychologically. A child can experience the appropriate balance of protection and freedom, or one, the overprotectiveness that infantilizes, or two, the underprotectiveness that demands of the child resources that may not yet exist. Specifically, he found 5 conditions associated with high self-esteem in children. 1. The child experiences total acceptance of thoughts, feelings, and the value of his or her person. 2. The child operates in a context of clearly defined and enforced limits that are fair, non-oppressive, and negotiable. The child is not given unrestricted freedom. 3. The child experiences respect for his or her dignity as a human being. The parents do not use violence or humiliation or ridicule to control and manipulate. 4. The parents uphold high standards and high expectations in terms of behavior and performance. Their attitude is not anything goes. 5. The parents themselves tend to enjoy a high level of self-esteem. They model what I call self-efficacy and self-respect. The child sees living examples of that which he or she needs to learn. The greater a child's terror and the earlier it is experienced, the harder the task of building a strong and healthy sense of self. To learn the 6 practices on the foundation of an all-consuming sense of powerlessness, traumatic powerlessness, is very difficult. One of the most powerful ways parents can convey love is through touch. Long before a child can understand words, he or she understands touch. Declarations of love without touch are unconvincing and hollow. Our bodies cry out for the reality of the physical. We want to experience that our person is loved, valued, embraced, not some disembodied abstraction. A child who is treated with love tends to internalize the feeling and to experience him or herself as lovable. Love is conveyed by verbal expression, nurturing actions, and the joy and pleasure we show in the sheer fact of the child's being. An effective parent can convey anger or disappointment without signaling withdrawal of love. An effective parent can teach without resorting to rejection. The value of the child as a human being is not on trial. A child whose thoughts and feelings are treated with acceptance tends to internalize the response and to learn self-acceptance. Acceptance is conveyed not by agreement, which is not always possible, but by listening to and acknowledging the child's thoughts and feelings, and by not chastising, arguing, lecturing, psychologizing, or insulting. A child who receives respect from adults tends to learn self-respect. Respect is conveyed by addressing a child with the courtesy one normally extends to adults. Especially important for the nurturing of a child's self-esteem is the experience of what I have called psychological visibility. If I express sadness and you convey empathy, or if I do something I am proud of and you smile in admiration, I feel seen and understood by you. I feel visible. When we feel visible, we feel that the other person and I are in the same reality, in the same universe, metaphorically speaking. When we don't, it is as if we were in different realities. But all satisfying human interactions require congruence at this level. If we do not experience ourselves as in the same reality, we cannot relate in a mutually satisfying way. When we convey love, appreciation, empathy, acceptance, respect, we make a child visible. When we convey indifference, scorn, condemnation, ridicule, we drive the child self into the lonely underground of invisibility. If a parent's goal is to support the child's independence, one of the ways this is achieved is to offer a child choices in keeping with the child's level of development. A mother may not think it advisable to ask her 5-year-old whether he or she wants to wear a sweater, but she can offer a choice of 2 sweaters. Some children are eager for an adult's advice when it is not necessary. It is helpful to respond, "What do you think?" One wants to turn over choice and decision-making to a child as fast as the child can comfortably handle them. Loving parents concerned to support the self-esteem of their children may believe that the way to do it is with praise. But inappropriate praise can be as harmful to self-esteem as inappropriate criticism. It is evaluative praise that does not serve a child's interests. Appreciative praise, in contrast, can be productive both in supporting self-esteem and in reinforcing desired behavior. If we state what we like and appreciate about the child's actions and accomplishments, we remain factual and descriptive. We leave it to the child to do the evaluating. The more specifically targeted our praise, the more meaningful it is to the child. Praise that is generalized and abstract leaves the child wondering what exactly is being praised. It is not helpful. Some parents are intent on helping their children's self-esteem, but they praise globally, indiscriminately, and extravagantly. At best, this does not work. At worst, it backfires. The child feels invisible and anxious. In addition, this policy tends to produce approval addicts, children who cannot take a step without looking for praise and who feel disvalued if it is not forthcoming. As to criticism, it needs to be directed only at the child's behavior, never at the child. The principle is: describe the behavior, hitting a sibling, breaking a promise. Describe your feelings about it, anger, disappointment. Describe what you want done, if anything, and omit character assassination. No good purpose is ever served by assaulting a child's self-esteem. This is the first rule of effective criticism. We do not inspire better behavior by impugning a child's worth, intelligence, morality, character, intentions, or psychology. Attacks on self-esteem tend to increase the likelihood that the unwanted behavior will happen again. Since I am bad, I will behave badly. It is no service to children to expect nothing of them. Rational parents uphold ethical standards to which they hold children accountable. They also uphold standards of performance. They expect children to learn, master knowledge and skills, and move toward increasing maturity. Making mistakes is integral to a great deal of learning. If a child is chastised for making a mistake, or ridiculed, humiliated, or punished, or if the parent steps in impatiently and says, "Here, let me do it," he or she cannot feel free to struggle and learn. A natural process of growth is sabotaged. To avoid mistakes becomes a higher priority than to master new challenges. A child who does not feel accepted by parents if he or she makes a mistake may learn to practice self-rejection in response to mistakes. Consciousness is muted, self-acceptance is undermined, self-responsibility and self-assertiveness are suppressed. There is perhaps nothing more important to know about children than that they need to make sense out of their experience. In effect, they need to know that the universe is rational and that human existence is knowable, predictable, and stable. On that foundation, they can build a sense of efficacy. Without it, the task is worse than difficult. If instead of obedience we want cooperation from our children, if instead of conformity we want self-responsibility, we can achieve it in a home environment that supports the child's mind. We cannot achieve it in an environment intrinsically hostile to the exercise of mind. A child may find the world of parents and other adults incomprehensible and threatening. The self is not nurtured, but attacked. The will to be conscious and efficacious is assaulted. After a number of unsuccessful attempts to understand adult policies, statements, and behavior, many children give up and take the blame for their feelings of helplessness. Often they sense miserably, desperately, and inarticulately that something is terribly wrong with their elders or with themselves or with something. Often children who survive extremely adverse childhoods have learned a particular survival strategy. I call it strategic detachment. This is not the withdrawal from reality that leads to psychological disturbance, but an intuitively calibrated disengagement from noxious aspects of their family life or other aspects of their world. They somehow know this is not all there is. They hold the belief that a better alternative exists somewhere and that someday they will find their way to it. A teacher who treats boys and girls with respect can provide enlightenment for a child struggling to understand human relationships who comes from a home where such respect is non-existent. A teacher who refuses to accept a child's negative self-concept and relentlessly holds to a better view of the child's potential has the power, sometimes, to save a life. Self-esteem in the schools. For some children, school is a legally enforced incarceration at the hands of teachers who lack either the self-esteem or the training or both to do their jobs properly. Feel-good notions are harmful rather than helpful. Yet if one examines the proposals offered to teachers on how to raise students' self-esteem, many are the kind of trivial nonsense that gives self-esteem a bad name, such as praising and applauding a child for virtually everything he or she does, dismissing the importance of objective accomplishments, handing out gold stars on every possible occasion, and propounding an entitlement idea of self-esteem that leaves it divorced from both behavior and character. When I write of self-efficacy or self-respect, I do so in the context of reality, not of feelings generated out of wishes or affirmations or gold stars granted as a reward for showing up. Self-esteem pertains to that which is open to our volitional choice. It cannot properly be a function of the family we were born into, or our race, or the color of our skin, or the achievements of our ancestors. These are values people sometimes cling to in order to avoid responsibility for achieving authentic self-esteem. Whereas in 1890, 90% of the children had grandparents living in the home, and in 1950, 40% living in the home, today the figure is down to 7%. Many brilliant minds have commented on their dismal experiences in school, their boredom, their lack of appropriate intellectual stimulation and nourishment, their sense that the last thing the educational system was designed for was the cultivation of minds. Schools were interested not in autonomy, but in the manufacture of someone's notion of good citizens. The assembly line has long since ceased to be the appropriate symbol of the workplace, as we have made the transition from a manufacturing to an information society, and mind work has largely replaced muscle work. What is needed and demanded today in the age of the knowledge worker is not robotic obedience, but persons who can think, who can innovate, originate, and function self-responsibly, who are capable of self-management, who can remain individuals while working effectively as members of teams, who are confident of their powers and their ability to contribute. What the workplace needs today is self-esteem. The aim must be to teach children how to think, how to recognize logical fallacies, how to be creative, and how to learn. This last is emphasized because of the speed with which yesterday's knowledge becomes inadequate to today's demands. Most work now requires a commitment to lifelong learning. What a great teacher, a great parent, a great psychotherapist, and a great coach have in common is a deep belief in the potential of the person with whom they are concerned, A conviction about what that person is capable of being and doing, plus the ability to transmit the conviction during their interactions. One of the greatest gifts a teacher can offer a student is the refusal to accept the student's poor self-concept at face value, seeing through it to the deeper, stronger self that exists within, if only as a potential. One of the painful things about being a child is that one tends not to be taken seriously by adults. Whether one is dismissed discourteously or praised for being cute, most children are not used to having their dignity as human beings respected. Children are extremely sensitive to issues of fairness. Compassion and respect do not imply lack of firmness. An emotion is both a mental and a physical event. It is an automatic psychological response involving both mental and physiological features to our subconscious appraisal of what we perceive as beneficial or harmful to ourselves. Emotions reflect the perceiver's value response to different aspects of reality. For me or against me, good for me or harmful, to be pursued or to be avoided, and so forth. To cease to know what we feel is to cease to experience what things mean to us. It is undeniable that too many parents encourage the practice of emotional repression by making it a tacit condition of their approval. As the child grows, he or she may slash away more and more feelings, more and more parts of the self, in order to be accepted, loved, and not abandoned. We can learn that we are accountable for what we choose to do, but that feelings as such are neither moral nor immoral. They simply are. Each person has a unique mixture of intelligences or ways of understanding the world: linguistic, logical, mathematical, spatial, musical, physical, the use of the body to solve problems or make things, understanding of others, and understanding of self. Also, each person has a different learning style. Some may respond best to visual information, others to language, lectures, reading. Others must touch or engage the physical world for things to make sense. Self-esteem and work. Let us remember the primary meaning of self-esteem. It is confidence in the efficacy of our mind and our ability to think. By extension, it is confidence in our ability to learn, make appropriate choices and decisions, and manage change. The survival value of such confidence is obvious, so is the danger when that trust is missing. The economic need for large numbers of people with decent levels of self-esteem is unprecedented and represents a turning point in our evolution. We are manufacturing more goods by far than ever before in our history, but with far fewer people. In earlier decades, roughly half the working population was employed in blue-collar jobs. Today, the figure is less than 18%, and estimates are that in not too many years it will be 10%. One needs to understand that the process can never stop, because new knowledge begins to make one's training obsolete almost as soon as one completes it. What we see is no longer management and workers, but an integration of specialists. Each of these specialists has knowledge and expertise not possessed by the others in the organization. Each is relied on to think, to create, to be innovative, to contribute. Workers become associates in an atmosphere that is becoming increasingly collegial rather than hierarchical. An over-attachment to the known and familiar has become costly and dangerous. It threatens both organizations and individuals with obsolescence. The idea of human life as a process of advancing from knowledge to new knowledge, from discovery to discovery, is only a couple of seconds old, measured in evolutionary time. Freedom means change. The ability to manage change is at least in part a function of self-esteem. From the boardroom to the factory floor, work is understood more and more clearly as an expression of thought. Books on business and management are filled with stories of contributions made by workers to the improvement of processes, services, and products. There are stories of men and women going far beyond their job description in response to unexpected problems they take responsibility for solving. Enterprise and initiative are no longer perceived as the monopoly of a few special people. They are perceived as traits appropriate to everyone. The question, "What has your birth determined you to be?" was replaced by the question, "What have you made of yourself?" In other words, identity was no longer something one inherited, but something one created. Self-reliance and self-responsibility were seen as supremely appropriate in this new order of things, in contrast to the conformity and obedience more valued in earlier tribal societies. Independence became an economically adaptive virtue. Entrepreneurship is by its very nature anti-authority. It is anti-status quo. It is always moving in the direction of making what exists obsolete. The essence of entrepreneurial activity is that of endowing resources with new wealth-producing capabilities, of seeing and actualizing productive possibilities that have not been seen and actualized before. This presupposes the ability to think for oneself, to look at the world through one's own eyes, a lack of excessive regard for the world as perceived by others, at least in some respects. If capitalism offered a broader arena for self-esteem to operate in than had ever existed before, it also offered challenges that had no precedent in earlier tribal societies, challenges to self-reliance, self-assertiveness, self-responsibility, and personal accountability. Capitalism created a market for the independent mind. If low self-esteem correlates with resistance to change and clinging to the known and familiar, then never in the history of the world has low self-esteem been as economically disadvantageous as it is today. The more unstable the economy and the more rapid the rate of change, which is clearly the world of the present and future, the more urgent the need for large numbers of self-esteeming individuals. As an extension of human intelligence, a machine substitutes the power of thought for the power of muscles. While making physical labor less demanding, it makes it more productive. As technological development keeps evolving, the ratio keeps shifting in favor of mind. And as mind becomes more important, self-esteem becomes more important. A commitment to lifelong learning is a natural expression of the practice of living consciously. The primary function of a leader in a business enterprise is 1. To develop and persuasively convey a vision of what the organization is to accomplish, and 2. To inspire and empower all those who work for the organization to make an optimal contribution to the fulfillment of that vision, and to experience that in doing so, they are acting in alignment with their self-interest. The leader must be an inspirer and a persuader. The higher the self-esteem of the leader, the more likely it is that he or she can perform that function successfully. The policies that support self-esteem are also the policies that make money. The policies that demean self-esteem are the policies that sooner or later cause a company to lose money, simply because when you treat people badly and disrespectfully, you cannot possibly hope to get their best. Self-esteem and psychotherapy. Sometimes problems could be understood as direct expressions of an underdeveloped self-esteem. For example, shyness, timidity, and fear of self-assertion or intimacy. Sometimes problems could be understood as consequences of the denial of poor self-esteem, that is, as defenses built against the reality of the problem. For example, controlling and manipulative behavior, obsessive-compulsive rituals, inappropriate aggressiveness, fear-driven sexuality, destructive forms of ambition, all aiming to produce some experience of efficacy, control, and personal worth. It seemed clear that problems that were manifestations of poor self-esteem were also contributors to the continuing deterioration of self-esteem. It is true that when anxiety and depression are diminished, the client feels stronger. It is also true that developing self-esteem diminishes anxiety and depression. I thought that self-esteem can and should be addressed explicitly, that it should set the context of the entire therapeutic enterprise. Almost all schools of therapy help clients to confront previously avoided conflicts or challenges. But I typically ask, how do you feel about yourself when you avoid an issue you know at some level needs to be dealt with? And how do you feel about yourself when you master your avoidance impulses and confront the threatening issue? I frame the process in terms of its consequences for self-esteem. Psychotherapy has two basic goals. One is the alleviation of suffering. The other is the facilitation and enhancement of well-being. On the one hand, psychotherapy aims to reduce irrational fears, depressive reactions, and troublesome feelings of every kind, perhaps from past traumatic experiences. On the other hand, it encourages the learning of new skills, new ways of thinking about and looking at life, better strategies for dealing with self and others, and an expanded sense of one's possibilities. I place both these goals in the context of aiming to strengthen self-esteem. Raising self-esteem is more than a matter of eliminating negatives, it requires the attainment of positives. The respect is unrelenting, whatever the client's behavior. The message is conveyed. A human being is an entity deserving respect. You are an entity deserving respect. A client for whom being treated in this manner may be a rare or even unique experience may be stimulated over time to begin to restructure his or her self-concept. A therapist who is uncomfortable with strong feelings needs to work on him or herself. To be able to listen serenely and with empathy is basic to the healing arts. I like to tell students, the goal is not to prove that you are brilliant. The goal is to assist clients to discover that they are brilliant. There is no need less recognized in most people than the need to contact their unidentified and possibly disowned resources. This is the need to understand the strengths they do not know they possess, the potentials they have never explored, the capacity for self-healing and self-development they have never summoned. Everyone who has any familiarity with psychology knows about the danger of disowning the murderer within. Far fewer people understand the tragedy of disowning the hero within. In psychotherapy, it is often easy enough to see the part of the individual that is neurotic. The challenge is to see and mobilize that part that is healthy. One of the secrets of Virginia Satir's great gifts as a family therapist was her conviction that people possessed all the resources they needed to solve their problems, and her ability to transmit that conviction to the people with whom she worked. In terms of producing results, it is one of the most important abilities a psychotherapist can possess. Humans are, by nature, problem solvers. The solutions we produce in response to the difficulties and challenges we encounter aim consciously or subconsciously at filling our needs. Sometimes the means we adopt are impractical and even self-destructive, neurotic. But at some level, our intention is to take care of ourselves. Even suicide can be understood as a tragic effort at self-care, perhaps escape from intolerable suffering. On a technical level, perhaps the two methods that most distinguish my approach are the use of sentence completions, which I have illustrated throughout this book as well as in several of my previous books, and working with sub-personalities. Unrecognized or disowned and rejected sub-selves tend to become sources of conflict, unwanted feelings, and inappropriate behavior. Sub-selves that are recognized, respected, and integrated into the total personality become sources of energy, emotional richness, increased options, and a more fulfilling sense of identity. No one could be completely whole who did not reconnect with and create a conscious and benevolent relationship with a child self. This task is especially important for the attainment of autonomy, I saw that when the task is neglected, the tendency is to look for healing from the outside, from other people, and this never works. The healing that is needed is not between self and others, but between adult self and child self. A sub-self or sub-personality is a dynamic component of an individual's psyche, having a distinctive perspective, value orientation, and personality of its own. The child self is the component of the psyche containing the personality of the child one once was, with that child's range of values, emotions, needs, and responses. I have never worked with a depressed personality whose child self did not feel hated, not merely ignored or rejected, by an older part. The teenage self is the component of the psyche containing the personality of the adolescent one once was, with that teenager's range of values, emotions, needs, and responses. Often when working with couples on relationship problems, an exploration of the teenage self is especially useful. This is the sub-self that often plays an important role in selecting a partner. And this is the mind state to which we often revert unconsciously during times of relationship difficulty or crisis. The opposite gender self is the component of the psyche containing the feminine subpersonality of the male and the masculine subpersonality of the female. There tends to be a fairly strong correlation between how we relate to the opposite gender in the world and how we relate to the opposite gender within. The man who professes to find women an incomprehensible mystery is almost certainly completely out of touch with the feminine within. We sometimes find that the process of self-acceptance is blocked and we do not know why. Mysterious voices inside our head generate relentless self-criticism. Self-acceptance feels like an ideal we can never fully realize. When this happens, working with subpersonalities can become an avenue to breakthrough. There are basic skills that every psychotherapist needs to do his or her work effectively. Human relationship skills, such as building rapport, creating an atmosphere of safety and acceptance, and conveying a perspective of hope and optimism. Then there are the skills a therapist needs to address specific problems, such as sexual difficulties, obsessive-compulsive disorders, or career problems. The approval each of us needs is from within. When we are children, we are dependent on others for the satisfaction of most of our needs. If we develop properly, we transfer the source of approval from the world to ourselves. We shift from the external to the internal. Some psychotherapists identify self-esteem exclusively with self-acceptance and treat it in effect as a birthright with no further effort required of the individual. This approach conveys a very limited view of what self-esteem is and requires. Important as self-acceptance is, the client will be left to wonder why it does not satisfy the hunger for something more, some height the client may yearn for, but have no inkling of how to reach, and no guidance. Self-esteem and culture. The dark and Middle Ages did not value self-assertion, did not understand individuality, could not conceive self-responsibility, had no grasp of the rights of man or the modern idea of political freedom, could not imagine innovativeness as a way of life, did not grasp the relation of mind, intelligence, and creativity to survival, had no place for self-esteem. Self-esteem, as we think about the concept today, has its roots in the post-Renaissance emerging culture of individualism. The root of the need for self-esteem is biological. It pertains to survival and continued efficacious functioning. The need is inherent in human nature. It is not an invention of Western culture. As for teamwork, group activity, and the like, the self-responsible person can function effectively with others precisely because he or she is willing to be accountable. Such a person is not a dependent, nor a parasite, nor an exploiter. Self-responsibility does not mean one does everything oneself. It means that when one acts in concert with others, one carries one's own weight. To the extent that a culture suppresses the natural impulse to self-assertion and self-expression, it blocks creativity, stifles individuality, and sets itself against the requirements of self-esteem. Nazi Germany and Soviet Russia, to name two examples in this century, ruthlessly punished self-assertiveness. In these countries, it was a cultural disvalue. They were not societies in which human life could flourish. Other cultures punish self-assertiveness and self-expression in less extreme and violent ways, sometimes in very gentle ways. Hawaiian children may be lovingly enjoined, remain among the clumps of grasses and do not elevate yourself. Self-expression is natural. Self-suppression is not. When fear is absent, self-assertiveness is the natural condition of human beings. What people may have to learn is comfort with and respect for the self-assertiveness of others. This is clearly an imperative of cooperation. Cooperation is not a middle ground between self-assertiveness and self-suppression, but the intelligent exercise of self-interest in a social context, which does have to be learned. Understood correctly, there is nothing intrinsically Western about a strong goal orientation. When Buddha set out in search of enlightenment, was he not moved by a passionate purpose? The question is our life and well-being better served by organizing our energies with relation to specific short and long-term purposes, or are they better served by living from day to day, reacting to events rather than choosing one's own direction, passively drifting at the whim of impulse and circumstance? If one holds to the Aristotelian perspective, as I do, that a proper human life is one in which we seek the fullest exercise of our distinctive powers, then the answer is obvious. In passivity, neither our reason, nor our passion, nor our creativity, nor our imagination fulfill themselves. We only half-life our existence. If a culture places relationships first, above autonomy and authenticity, it leads the individual to self-alienation. To be connected is more important than to know who I am and to be who I am. Every society contains a network of values, beliefs, and assumptions, not all of which are named explicitly, but which nonetheless are part of the human environment. Indeed, ideas that are not identified overtly, but are held and conveyed tacitly, can be harder to call into question, precisely because they are absorbed by a process that largely bypasses the conscious mind. Everyone possesses what might be called a cultural unconscious, a set of implicit beliefs about nature, reality, human beings, man-woman relationships, good and evil, that reflect the knowledge, understanding, and values of a historical time and place. The essence of the tribal mentality is that it makes the tribe as such the supreme good and denigrates the importance of the individual. It tends to view individuals as interchangeable units and to ignore or minimize the significance of differences between one human being and another. The tribal premise is intrinsically anti-self-esteem. It is a premise and an orientation that disempowers the individual qua individual. Its implicit message is, you don't count. By yourself, you are nothing. Only as part of us can you be something. Jonathan Rauch, commenting on the older aspects of Japanese culture, there is a disturbing side of Japan, a traditional, pre-liberal side. The baseball teams often train their players to the point of pain and exhaustion on the grounds that this will build strength of spirit. In high school hazings, underclassmen are humiliated and bullied on the understanding that they will get their own turn at bullying when they become upperclassmen. In the ever-present Japanese seniority systems, the young suffer and pay their dues and learn to endure and accept and later inflict the same. When educators introduced self-esteem curricula into the schools, the most fervent opponents were Christian fundamentalists. They denounce such programs as self-worship. They argue that self-esteem alienates children from God. Throughout history, wherever religion has been state-enforced, consciousness has been punished. For the sin of thinking, men and women have been tortured and executed. This is why the American idea of the absolute separation of church and state was of such historic significance. It forbade any religious group to use the machinery of government to persecute those who thought or believed differently. When beliefs are arrived at not by a process of reason but by faith and alleged revelation, when there are no objective criteria of knowledge to appeal to, those who think differently are often perceived by believers as a threat, a danger, capable of spreading the disease of non-belief to others. In any culture, subculture, or family in which belief is valued above thought and self-surrender is valued above self-expression and conformity is valued above integrity, those who preserve their self-esteem are likely to be heroic exceptions. What was so historically extraordinary about the creation of the United States of America was its conscious rejection of the tribal premise. The Declaration of Independence proclaimed the revolutionary doctrine of individual, inalienable rights and asserted that the government exists for the individual, not the individual for the government. The 20th century witnessed a shift in cultural values in the United States. And predominantly, the shift has not supported higher self-esteem, but has encouraged the opposite. I am thinking of the ideas I was taught in college and university during the 1950s, when epistemological agnosticism, not to say nihilism, joined hands with moral relativism, which joined hands with Marxism. The American culture is a battleground between the values of self-responsibility and the values of entitlement. A culture of self-esteem is a culture of accountability, which means of self-responsibility. There is no other way for human beings to prosper or to live benevolently with one another. Cultures do not encourage the questioning of their own premises. One of the meanings of living consciously has to do with one's awareness that other people's beliefs are just that, their beliefs, and not necessarily ultimate truth. This does not mean that living consciously expresses itself in skepticism. It expresses itself in critical thinking. The challenge is not to take the assumptions of one's culture as a given as reality, but to realize that assumptions can be questioned. The average person tends to judge him or herself by the values prevalent in his social environment, as transmitted by family members, political and religious leaders, teachers, newspaper and television editorials, and popular art, such as movies. If I live a life of unthinking routine with no challenges or crises, I may be able to evade for a while the fact that what I possess is not self-esteem, but pseudo-self-esteem. When everything is all right, everything is all right, but that is not how we determine the presence of self-esteem. Genuine self-esteem is what we feel about ourselves when everything is not all right. Conclusion, the seventh pillar of self-esteem. The need for self-esteem is a summons to the hero within us. It means a willingness and a will to live the six practices when to do so may not be easy. We may need to overcome inertia, face down fears, confront pain, or stand alone in loyalty to our own judgment, even against those we love. Living consciously requires an effort. Generating and sustaining awareness is work. The other dragon we may need to slay is the impulse to avoid discomfort. Taking the long view, it is easy to see that high self-esteem people are happier than low self-esteem people. Self-esteem is the best predictor of happiness we have. But in the short term, self-esteem requires the willingness to endure discomfort when that is what one's spiritual growth entails. Here is the basic pattern. First, we avoid what we need to look at because we do not want to feel pain. Then our avoidance produces further problems for us, which we also do not want to look at because they evoke pain. Then the new avoidance produces additional problems we do not care to examine, and so on. Layer of avoidance is piled on layer of avoidance, disowned pain on disowned pain. This is the condition of most adults. Here's the reversal of the basic pattern. First, we decide that our self-esteem and our happiness matter more than short-term discomfort or pain. We take baby steps at being more conscious, self-accepting, responsible, and so on. We notice that when we do this, we like ourselves more. This inspires us to push on and attempt to go farther. We become more truthful with ourselves and others. Self-esteem rises. We take on harder assignments. We feel a little tougher, a little more resourceful. It becomes easier to confront discomforting emotions and threatening situations. We feel we have more assets with which to cope. We become more self-assertive. We feel stronger. We are building the spiritual equivalent of a muscle. Experiencing ourselves as more powerful, we see difficulties in more realistic perspective. We may never be entirely free of fear or pain, but they have lessened immeasurably and we are not intimidated by them. Integrity feels less threatening and more natural. If the process were entirely easy, if there was nothing hard about it at any point, if perseverance and courage were never needed, everyone would have good self-esteem. But a life without effort, struggle, or suffering is an infant's dream. Always, will is needed. Perseverance is needed. Courage is needed. The energy for this commitment can only come from the love we have for our own life. This love is the beginning of virtue. It is the launching pad for our highest and noblest aspirations. It is the motive power that drives the six pillars. It is the seventh pillar of self-esteem. And with that, I conclude my highlights of this very long-winded book. I hope you got something out of it. Take care.